big hope that fintech would be able to make a large dent in the global fight against poverty. Based on numbers by provided by IMF, there's over 1.7 billion people in the world that's financially excluded. In the case of the country, the reach of the banking system is only about a third. So there's about two-thirds without access to formal banking system. I'm sure they have access to financing, but financing that's very costly. For example, the traditional 5-6, if you compute that, that's over 1,000 percent. And that's why I'm happy that there are alternatives already. Recently, I met a startup called Buhay. They started in Indonesia. They're basically financing for tuition payments. No? And this is very important because a lot of students sometimes have to quit school because they cannot pay the tuition. So Buhay is a startup that will offer loans, especially to third and fourth year students, and pay directly to schools so that they can continue with their education. And the rates that they charge is actually lower than credit card. No? So that's why fintech for me offers a lot of potential, and I'm hopeful that the ecosystem in the country can continue to grow. That's one reason that I've been observing what's going on around the world in other countries in terms of how they promote fintech. Some of us obviously are very aware of what's happening in China, where if you pay in cash, they give you an unusual look of you know, what planet you've been from. No? So that's anecdotal, but I think in reality, they're almost proceeding to a cashless world. No? But other countries as well are moving aggressively towards you know, promoting fintech. One country in particular, the other large country in the world, India. I was in a conference where I was listening to the former central bank governor of India give a presentation, former Reserve Bank of India Governor Subbarao, no? And he referred to the JAM Trinity, J-A-M Trinity, that is the cornerstone of their effort to push digitalization in their country. The JAM Trinity stands for first Aadhaar, no? Which is a Hindi word for foundation. And basically, the foundation that they built is a mandatory digital ID. So they launched a digital ID for everyone across the nation, over 1 billion users. It features a biometric authenticated 12-digit number. The second part of that JAM Trinity that he was talking about is a mandatory. You know, basically, they pushed everyone to have bank accounts. You know? So on the first day of these efforts to encourage everyone to have bank accounts, they had 10 million new bank account holders, free, zero balance. So you don't have to have a balance, because that's a problem with a lot of people. They cannot afford to have balances in their bank accounts. No? And they even added an incentive. It carries an insurance coverage of $1,500. This is the government pushing this whole effort. As of April 2019, they have over 355 million accounts, representing about a quarter of their population, with balances of $14.4 billion. Not that much yet, but the fact that four times our population now have bank accounts, no? I think is a big step towards encouraging digitalization in India. Then finally, the third part of their strategy is mobile payments. No? Basically, the government decided and just made a, they drew a line and they said, we're not going to pay in cash or check anymore. We're all now going to pay digitally in mobile payments. So they also have something akin to our conditional cash transfer program. So those people who actually get money from the government, you must have a bank account and you must have a digital ID if you want to get your money. And transactions with the government is being encouraged to be in the digital form. No? Our government, no, especially the BSP, has been quite proactive, especially under the administration of the late former governor of the Central Bank, Nesting Espanilla. No? He actually created a digital sandbox where you can experiment, no, with new products, no, and make it easier for new entrants to comply with the regulatory requirements of the BSP. No? So the regulators and government can actually be a friend in this effort to push forward with fintech and digitalization. India is actually not unique, nor China. No? There are other countries, smaller countries such as Estonia, no? A small country of over a million people, which is considered to be the most digitally advanced country in Europe. And again, what they did was basically require everyone to have IDs, force government to invest in technology and allow people to deal with government through the net. No? And again, encouraging people to participate, no? And then making sure that the interaction with the citizen is through the net. And that's what they call their e-citizen program. No? Closer to home, you have Singapore. No? Those of you who've been to Singapore, obviously, when you visit Singapore, it's like visiting the future, no? In terms of how well they run their country. No? Obviously, it's a small country, but they've shown us how good governance and technology can combine to really create a very competitive nation. And they even put money where their mouth is. No? They've committed over 200 million Singapore dollars for the next 5 years to support fintech startups. No? They also have a fintech festival where startups can actually show their ideas and share it with potential investors. So across the world, there is a push towards making technology, you know, an ally to make the world a better place, not just to simplify the way we do things, but to actually alleviate poverty, to make sure that everyone gets an opportunity to improve their lives. The beauty about this whole infrastructure is that an individual can have a massive market immediately, especially if you have a great idea and a great product. You don't have to invest in a lot of stores, because if you have access to the internet, you suddenly have the world, the whole world, as your audience. And that's why it's important that the collaboration between government and the private sector continue, not just in regulation, but also in infrastructure. The Philippines now is enjoying the benefits of regulatory moves that was done many years ago in terms of the boom in BPO industry. The BPO business would not have been possible if in 1992, the Ramos administration did not liberalize the telco industry. Because before then, the telco industry was a monopoly. And in fact, that was the year the year of the last visit of Lee Kuan Yew to the Philippines. And he had this famous speech where he said, 90% of Filipinos are waiting for phone lines and 10% are waiting for dial tones. No? And President Ramos got upset and he liberalized the telco industry. And fortunately, he reacted that way. Now we have the BPO industry. But the world is moving. The whole world's moving rapidly. Even the BPO industry as we know it will not be with us unless we continue to invest in technology. For example, the voice sector, where we are dominant, we can lose that soon if we don't start investing and going up the value chain. Because when you call right now, the first voice that you actually normally talk to now are not of people, live people, but of robots, no? Artificial intelligence and technology combining to be able to answer your basic questions. And then they will actually tell you that they will now shift you to a live call center agent if you have a more complex question. And that just shows you that on the one side, the developments in technology offers a lot of opportunity, but on the other hand, it is a threat. And that is why all of us will have to be on our toes, making sure that we as a company, we as a country, and even we as people continue to keep abreast with the latest developments in technology, because if not, we all will become obsolete and we will become irrelevant.